Rita said it's well for the pun. A couple of things before we get to the main tent idea tonight. First of all, as usual, the lovely and talented Joy Rotenberg has something to discuss from the Arts Council, our lovely sponsors.
I must be in her place because I don't know if she's lovely and talented. Sunday, April the 10th, is the Weston Philharmonic's annual fundraiser to have money to continue to do our programs in the schools, which reaches 7,000 school children a year. We're very proud of that. We are offering a fantastic program. The Symphony of the Americas will be bringing their 7 or 8 piece jazz band. So you're going to hear Glenn Miller and all those wonderful people that you know and love. Maybe we'll even get a dance for them, but I can't promise. However, there are two people that you all know well, Roger Lander and Joe Friedman, who are being honored that afternoon. So it would be very nice to have a nice showing for them, and it's going to be a delightful afternoon. Sunday, April 10th, 2 to 5, Weston Hills Country Club. Tickets are $50, but that is because we're trying to raise money for the schools. Flyers are on the back table, so take one with you. We'll take tickets up till probably 1 o'clock Sunday. But if you could pay us or let us know ahead, we'll make all the arrangements necessary. Tickets are at Glamopolitan, which is a salon in Town Center. But just go on site or call one of us and we'll definitely see that you get tickets. All the information is also in our Arts Council e-blast, which is just coming out probably tomorrow or the next day. I hope to see all of you there. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Joy. So normally I don't really make announcements on behalf of myself or an organization that I'm involved with, but tonight I'm going to. I think a number of you have seen several of you, me and friends of ours running around in Midtown. What we're trying to do is organize a foundation for autistic children who are 18 to 30 years old. So they're really autistic adults. And what you may not know, what I didn't know, is that they're very well taken care of up and through high school. But once kids graduate from high school, at least 37% of them never leave their house. That's because they can't find a job, they're not well educated enough. They have some restrictions in terms of their work ethic. That is, to work a normal 8-hour day is a real stretch, but they are very, very bright, by and large, at least the ones that we're dealing with, high-function autistic young adults and people with on the spectrum with Asperger's. And what we're trying to do is identify the needs of those young adults and put them together with organizations that can help them. So, for example, on the West Coast of the United States, there's a company called MindSpark. Now, you wouldn't normally think about this, but MindSpark trains autistic people to be software testers. So instead of working in a car wash or in the back room of a kitchen of a restaurant, here they are, they can actually produce very effective software testing and make somewhere between $75,000 and $150,000 a year. So we're trying to get a couple of universities, namely Kaiser and Nova, to adapt a program much like that, and also find companies within South Florida to do that. Also, finding housing for people like this is a challenge because they have to learn to live on their own, and so on and so on. And I don't want to take tonight to tell you about that. But what we did do is put together a brochure, a very, very simple brochure that I'd like you to pick up. It's in the back, and it tells you a little bit about us. There is no solicitation yet on this. We've applied to become a 501c3 Internal Revenue Service charitable organization, so our donations will be tax deductible. And we'll talk about this a little bit more as we go forward. So that's that. And please do pick up copy of this and see me if you want further information. Now, I know we haven't a meeting tonight, but our final meeting of the season is April 21st, and we have the sheriff of Broward County coming to talk to us about what's going on and answer questions at Q&A. Now, it's just happenstance that it's a political year, but he's here and he's running. I think the important part, frankly, is that you can ask him what's on your mind about anything having to do with public safety and policing. And just judging from what's in the news, it's an awfully hot topic. And I think the idea that he would come here and spend an evening with us to discuss this is really worthwhile. So I'll be sending out the notice over the weekend, and I appreciate if you give me a sense of how many are here. Okay, on to the topic at hand. First of all, yes?
Who is coming?
Sheriff Scott is with
us. Thank you.
The sheriff has a staff of 5,800 people. The sheriff does. And I believe it is the third largest police force in the United States.
Oh, wow.
And includes fire, all kinds of stuff. So it's a big deal. And I really think I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say, and I think you'll enjoy it too. So first of all, let me acknowledge the guy who made this possible, and it's not these guys, although they're making it possible. It's this fellow right here, Marty Ardman.
All right, Marty.
So Marty was
Larry. Yeah.
Larry, lift the mic. So I want to just quickly tell you about how Marty was exemplary in terms of what we've been asking for, which is give us ideas about speakers. So Marty comes up to me and goes, I got a really good speaker. I heard him, and he's terrific. And I said, great. So Marty hooks us up on a three-way phone call with Rich Levine from Neuberger and Berman. And we're talking, and Rich sounds like a pretty good guy, and he really knows his stuff. And interesting topic that we're going to talk about. The topic is investing for retirees in the turbulent market. I think it's something that we're probably all interested in. So, and then Marty and Rich get together and decide that stuff would be appropriate. So I want to thank Rich, Neuberger Berman, and Marty for putting this all together. So Rich has brought a colleague of his from Neuberger Berman. He's going to tell you all about what they are and what they do, but not pitch you on them. But if you're interested, there's a fairly large-sized brochure in the back with his card. So Marc, please come on up.
All right, thanks. First off, thank you everyone for coming. We appreciate the time. It sounds like you've had some great speakers here over the years, some high-quality folks, sheriffs, FBI directors, sex therapists. All very interesting, so I'm sorry to say we're really bringing the quality down. Rich, you better be better than a sex therapist. First of all, we work in an organization called Neuberger. Neuberger, some of you may be familiar with it, some may not. The firm was founded in 1939 by an individual of Roy Neuberger. Roy had a lot of different ideas and a lot of different thoughts in terms of how to manage money. But probably one of the most important, which people at our firm still enjoy and still resonate with everyone, was recognizing that different money managers have different ways of doing things. And although there may be an equity strategy or 10 different equity strategies, each manager can have a different style, a different way of getting really from point A to point B. Some with more volatility, some with less, some with more income, some with less. Rich is one of those groups. And I will tell you, there are roughly around 100 different strategies at our firm. As of today, we are roughly 2,000 individuals working at Neuberger, 34 offices throughout the world, and we manage roughly $240 million. We are one of the largest employee-controlled asset management firms in the country. Rich, myself, are both partners at the firm, and I will tell you again, we are thrilled to be here. We consider it an honor and a privilege. Now, of that $240 billion, it varies. We have about $100 billion in fixed income, $100 billion in equities, and $40 billion in alternatives. And alternatives these days can mean everything under the sun. Private equity, hedge funds, all these wonderful things. But as I said, there's all these different pots at Neuberger. And many folks think of us as more of a co-op manager, sharing resources, sharing ideas, and bouncing different ways of doing things off each other. Rich's group, the MLG group, has one of these different pots, and it is a team of bright folks that are very diligent and very, very experienced in managing client assets. Manage both institutional and high net worth individual dollars. Now, what do I do? Beyond just put brochures, and it took a lot of time putting those brochures back. My role, I'm a wealth advisor at Neuberger. I've been there approximately 11 years. They haven't given me my notice yet, so let's hope I make it to 12. My job as a wealth advisor, returning by education, but my skill set is frankly working with clients, both institutions and high net worth folks, to really develop solutions. With all these 100 different strategies at the firm, I use them as tools. And depending on each client's personal situation, we customize approaches that ultimately solve for their needs. And we tweak those, we modify, we customize those on a regular basis, and we work with clients in really building through this process. Tonight, we have Rich, and I'm not going to introduce you as one of those. It's probably not the right thing to say. But I'm fortunate to call him a colleague, a friend, and with that, the mic is all yours. Thanks.
Thanks, Marc. Thanks, Marty, for setting this up, and for Larry for seeing it through. And so I buy stocks and bonds for clients for a living, and I really give speeches very often. So you'll bear with me. I made a couple of notes that will help me get through this a little bit, perhaps. I like to do this on an informal basis. If I'm speaking too quickly, because I'm from New York City, and you want me to slow down, let me know. If you want me to talk louder, let me know. If you want me to be funnier, let me know. I'll try to do that. Or smarter, for that matter. And if you have questions on what the topic is, please don't hesitate to raise your hand and ask as we go along. We're going to leave time at the end for Marc and I to take questions on broader topics as well. But just for background, a lot of my clients are retired. Either they're retired or they're thinking about retirement. And I think the demographic here is probably pretty similar. So this is a good group for me to talk to because this is what we do for a living. Retired typically means older. Older typically means more conservative. And more conservative typically means buying more bonds, more fixed income. Right? The essence of a bond is it pays you a certain amount of income. The bond comes to you, you get your money back. No more, no less. As long as the company hasn't gone bankrupt, at least you get your money back. And then you buy another bond if you want. You start all over again. So this is a particularly difficult time to buy bonds for people. And the reason is that interest rates are really low. Right? I've been at Neuberger now for 26 years. And when I started in 1989, you could buy bonds, U.S. government bonds. Right? I remember buying 7-year bonds that were paying 8%. Right? So today, yields are pathetic. Interest rates are very close to historically low numbers. And it's really not as exciting to buy bonds. Traditionally, people buy bonds for two reasons. They want safety, they want income. And right now, I would tell you, you can get one or the other. You can have safety, or you can have income, but it's really hard to have both right now. So to start off, I just want to define a couple of terms. I'm going to use whenever I talk about bond math, a lot of people roll their eyes. And I want to try and make this as straightforward and hopefully as simple as possible so you can see what's going on in the bond market right now. This is an example of a real live bond. Right? Your broker might call you, or you might hear about it from somebody else. They're going to buy you a municipal bond. Right? So the income is tax-free. That's great. It's got a 5% coupon. The bond matures in 10 years. It's trading at 108, and it's callable in 2 years. I'm going to explain all these terms and what they mean. Right? Just for round numbers, I can only deal in round numbers. We're going to use $100,000 as the example, but it doesn't really change. So you buy a $100,000 bond with a 5% coupon. But what does that mean? It means you're going to get $5,000 every year until the bond matures. Precisely, you're going to get half of that, $2,500, every 6 months until the bond matures. But $5,000 a year, that's the coupon. And sometimes, if brokers aren't being particularly direct with their clients, that's what they talk about. I got a 5% coupon, isn't that great? 5%, that's terrific. Well, it sounds great, but you need to understand the bond math to understand whether it really is a good deal or not. All right, so the next term you need to know is what's the current yield. The current yield is the income you're going to get divided by the price of the asset you're going to buy. Well, my example was 108. What does 108 mean? 108, when you talk about bonds, that's the percentage of the par value that you pay. So you buy a bond at 108, it's 108%. So you're buying that bond for $108,000. So the current yield, very simple, is $5,000 of income divided by $108,000 of cost for that bond. The current yield, pure division, is 4.6%. Just double check, right? 4.6. So far, so good. 4.6% sounds pretty good too, but we're not done, right? The next thing you need to know is what's the yield to maturity, right? Because I can tell you one thing about that bond you're buying for $108,000. When it matures, you're not getting $108,000. You're going to get back the par value. You're going to get back $100,000. Never going to get more, right? So the bond's going to go from $108,000 to $100,000. You need to take that loss of principal, of that value, into account in calculating the yield to maturity. Well, my example, you're going to lose $8,000 in value over 10 years, right? So you're losing roughly 0.8% each year, not exactly, but roughly 0.8% each year. And the yield to maturity is now slowed at 5% coupon, 4.6% current yield, now we're down to 3.8% as your yield to maturity. And even 3.8% doesn't sound so bad. But the kicker here is that bond's callable. Now what does that mean? That means at the issuer's option, let's say you bought a bond in the state of Florida, they issued the bond. At their option, not yours, but their option, in 2 years, they can call the bond. That means they're going to give you your money back then. Not 10 years from now, in 2 years. And what you need to know is what is the yield to call? That's the expression, all right? So you've got a 5% coupon, you've got a 4.6% current yield, you've got a 3.8% yield to maturity. The yield to call, you're going to lose $8,000 in 2 years. You're going to lose 4% roughly each year. Not exactly. The yield to call is 0.6%. 0.6%. That's your yield to call. And that is what you need to think about. Now, it just so happens that for a AAA rated municipal bond, that's not so bad. I know it sounds terrible, but in terms of what is available in the marketplace, 0.6% for a 2-year AAA rated bond, that's what the market bears right now. Because money market funds and savings accounts and checking accounts are all paying nothing, or almost nothing. So 0.6% tax-free is not such a terrible investment, but it's a long way from 5%. You need to understand what you're getting when you buy a bond. And if someone calls you up and says, I got a 5% bond, you need to ask, what's the yield to maturity? What's the yield to call, right? And the way to get the right numbers is ask, what's the yield to worse? What's the worst thing that could happen? What's the yield to worse? Because lo and behold, remember, it's the issuer's choice, not your choice, whether that bond disappears in 2 years, all right? So that's what you get for a high quality, 2-year, AAA rated municipal bond, less than 1%. There are a couple of ways to get better yields on bonds. Hold on a second. I have to stay in the focus of the camera here. I'm going to stay dead center. Two ways to get a better yield on a bond. One way is to buy a longer-term bond. 2-year bonds might be paying less than 1%. 5-year bonds pay a little bit more. 10-year bonds, 20-year bonds, 30-year bonds pay more than that. The other way to get a better yield on your bond buy a lower quality bond, right? Highest quality of any bond you could buy, U.S. Treasuries, right? Next highest would be considered AAA, AA, single A, triple B, and so on, right? When you go down in quality, you're taking more risk than whoever you're lending the money to. And that's what a bond is. You're lending money to somebody, to the U.S. government, to the state of Florida, to a company, whoever it might be. If you're lending money to somebody who's not as safe, you get paid more interest, but you're taking the risk that they go bankrupt and you don't get your money back. Right? The classic example would be Lehman Brothers, right? 2008, you had a Lehman Brothers bond, you didn't get your money back with it matured. That's cents on the dollar. So consider the risk there. If you're going to buy high quality bonds, short-term high quality bonds, I would say for the moment, I like the idea of buying individual bonds. Remember, the essence of a bond is this maturity date, and you get your money back at that moment in time. You get to start all over again if you want. And for safety, getting your money back is really a good thing. If you buy a bond fund, bond funds really only can compete on one topic. What are they going to tell you about their bond fund? What's the yield? In order to get a better yield, a lot of bond funds are going to take some kind of risk that you may not see as an investor. And again, either they're taking credit risk, they're buying lower quality bonds, or they're taking interest rate risk, they're buying longer term bonds. We'll come back to interest rate risk in a second. Or they're on leverage, they're borrowing money and buying even more bonds to try and get you a better return. All those things contribute to risk. So if you're buying bonds for safety, and you're buying high-quality short-term bonds, be safe. Buy individual bonds. I would say buy pieces of $25,000 or more. If you buy little pieces, you need to sell them someday, you're not going to get a good price if you put them out for bid. So round numbers, at least $25,000 if you can. Diversified portfolios, not just one issue, but lots of different issuers if you can. And individual bonds, you get your money back. But high yield is a different story. Right? Who knows the other word for high yield, by the way?
Junk.
Junk, right? So we'll use the term that people on Wall Street call it. Junk bonds are anything rated less than triple B, right? The triple B or above is considered investment grade. Below triple B is considered junk bonds. And it goes from double B to single B to all the way down. The lower the quality, the more the interest, the bigger the risk. If you're going to buy junk bonds, and it may make sense to do that with a small amount of money, if you're going to do that, I would tell you a bond fund is the right way to do it. Because diversification is critically important if you're going to buy high-yield bonds. Don't buy one bond. Don't buy five bonds. You want to buy a bond fund that owns 50, 80, 100 different bonds. So if any one of them actually goes bankrupt, you're not going to get wiped out. So for high quality, we like individual bonds. For high yield, we like bond funds. Right? You know, mutual fund that owns high-yield bonds is just a diversified way to own lots of different bonds. Let's go back for a second, talk about long-term bonds. For some people, a lot of clients I talk to say, why don't we buy, you know, instead of buying a 3-year bond or a 5-year bond, buy me a 10-year bond or a 20-year bond. I want the higher interest. And here's where bond math gets a little bit complicated. If you buy a bond with a coupon, that coupon is fixed. It's not going to change. Some bonds are exceptions, but most bonds, that coupon is a fixed obligation. That's why they call it fixed income. So imagine you buy a 30-year bond, and it's paying you 3% just for a number. And all of a sudden, interest rates go up. And new bonds are paying 4. And your bond's still going to pay you 3. If you hold it to maturity, you'll get your money back. So, you know, the basics don't change. But if you want to sell that bond, someone with a calculator, or these days, someone with a computer, is going to, you know, hit their fingers on the keyboard, and in 5 seconds will tell you how much less your bond is worth. Your bond is paying 3. You'll trade at a discount. And in that example, that bond will trade down by about 18-20% value. That $100,000 bond you bought on your statement next time is going to show up at $82,000. Now, some people say, I don't care, I'm going to hold it to maturity, it doesn't matter, and that's okay, but just, if you don't like the idea that your bonds will go down by potentially a meaningful amount of money, because rates could go up a lot more than 1%, then you don't want to own long-term bonds. Like I said earlier, interest rates are really close to rock bottom rates at this point in time. Could they go down? They could. You know, rates are even lower in Europe than they are here. But in December, this past December, for the first time in 8 years, 9 years, something like that, the Fed raised rates now, to a very low number still. They didn't raise rates in January, which some people expected. They didn't raise rates in March, which some people expected. Whether they do it in April is, I guess, unlikely at this point in time. But they could do it in June. They could do it, you know, the last thing that Janet Yellen said, the chairman of the Fed, is that based on current data, it looks like maybe we'll get 2 rate increases this year, right? The original premise was 4, 1.25, now we're down to 2, maybe 1 in June, maybe 1 in December, it depends on how the economy does, depends on a lot of things, but to us, I would expect interest rates to move higher over the next year or two, right? Not dramatically, not really quickly, but rates are going to generally be moving higher, and after rates have gone up, not once or twice, but maybe 3 or 4 times, or maybe even more, then it might be the time to buy longer-term bonds, and they're paying a decent rate of return. Right? Not to buy them now, when rates are still incredibly low. One, you're locking in a lousy return, but two, you're going to take a loss of principal if you want to sell that bond before maturity. So for our clients, typically, if you have IRA money, tax-sheltered money, You're buying treasuries, maybe, or you're buying corporate bonds. Right? Corporate bonds, you know, again, are not as safe as the U.S. government, so they pay a little bit more. But you buy high-quality bonds. There's a handful of AAA bonds around. Johnson & Johnson and Exxon and Microsoft come to mind. Those bonds pay a little bit more than treasuries, but not a lot more, but you pick up a little bit. And in a tax-sheltered account like an IRA, that might make perfect sense. There's one advantage, not for folks who are Florida residents, right? Because there's no state income tax here. So I don't know if you're all Florida residents or not, but up in New York, where I'm from, if you live in New York City, you pay federal and state and city income taxes. The one advantage of a treasury over a corporate bond is that treasury income is exempt from state and city income tax. You gotta pay federal tax on it. But if you don't pay state or city income tax, buy a bond from Exxon, I've got to pay federal and state and city taxes. So most of my clients, for money that is not IRA money, for money that is in a personal account, it could be a personal account, it could be a joint account, it could be a trust account, money you're paying taxes on. A lot of those clients buy tax-exempt bonds, especially, you know, if you're in a high tax bracket. Tax-exempt bonds will pay less than a corporate bond. You're actually taking a lower return on a gross basis. But if you think about it, if I gave you a choice, we'd rather have 2.5% taxable or 2% tax-free. Which would you rather have? The answer becomes kind of a pure math answer. If the maturities are the same and the quality is the same, it's only the taxes, the answer to that question is a function of what your tax rate is. Right? If your tax rate turns out to be a third, that's the right number, or higher, then you're better off with the tax-free bond paying 2, than the taxable bond paying 2.5. So you need to know your tax bracket. When you do your taxes this year, if you haven't done them yet, you'll be doing them soon, presumably, or if you've done them, go back and look at your tax return. I don't want to know, or you don't need to know your average tax rate. You need to know your marginal tax rate, right? Which could be different than your average tax rate. You want to know what your marginal tax rate is, what that next dollar of income would be. That's the rate you apply in this calculation, whether you want taxable bonds or taxable bonds. Okay, I'm gonna hold off on bonds now. I guess if any questions on bonds, happy to take them, otherwise I'm gonna change topics a little bit. Okay with bonds, all right, good. Now we talk about stocks. So the basic premise that we're working from is that in the long run, stocks do better than bonds. In the long run. So, historically, over many, many years, over decades, the average return in the bond is 4, 5, 6%. And the average return in the stock market has been at 10, 11, 12%. And the average return in the S&P 500, 500 largest stocks over the last 70 years, is a little bit over 11%. And for the bonds, like I said, right around 4 or 5%. Now, right now, it seems hard to imagine how you get 4 or 5% in the bonds. And also, it seems hard to imagine how you get 10 or 12 in the stock market. But historically, those are the numbers. The question is, how much volatility are you willing to withstand to invest in the stock market? So here we are. Today is the last day of March, right? And I didn't get the final number, but I think the S&P is very close to dead even the first quarter of 2016. Nothing happened, right? Well, I would tell you, if you were actually following it, the hint day by day, in the first 6 weeks of this year, the S&P was down about 10%. Now, that's a lot to be down in 6 weeks. And in the next 6 weeks, since February 11th was actually the bottom, and you know what happened on February 12th, just a little bit of a side note? Jamie Dimon, right? You know who Jamie Dimon is? Jamie Dimon is the CEO of JP Morgan. On January 12th, before the market opened, JP Morgan made an announcement that Jamie Dimon took $26 million of his own money and bought JP Morgan stock. And I don't know if it's just coincidence or not, but the market started going up that day. Really, that was, felt like the turning point. And so the market has rallied back to the point where the 10% we lost in the first 6 weeks, we made it all back. So the S&P is flat. So it gives you an idea of what kind of volatility you can expect. If 10% swing is too much for you, then you shouldn't be in stocks. Because that could happen, and a lot worse could happen. For those of you who invested in the stock market in 2008, right? The S&P was, anybody know the number? S&P was was down 37% in 2008. 37% even, that was the number, 37%. And then just to make sure you were paying attention, in the first 2 months of 2009, it was down another 20%. Right? It hit bottom in March of 2009. Now, we had a spectacular rally since then. We made all that money back and a lot more, but being down more than 50% in what was about 6-8 months was pretty earth-shattering. Now, I don't think we're going to get a repeat in 2008. At least I hope not. Right? I hope that was a once-in-a-lifetime kind of event. But there are risks of investing in stocks. If you're going to invest in stocks, we think it's very important to be diversified. We think it's very important to use professional management. Obviously, we at Neuberger Berman volunteer to do that for people. And we do it a couple of different ways. We manage mutual funds. Anybody with $1,000 or more can come along and put their money into a mutual fund. And we manage individual accounts. People come to us and we build portfolios of individual stocks for them. But I want to talk about something slightly different. Right? Because most people who buy stocks are buying stocks because they're going to appreciate, at least they hope they're going to appreciate. That's the goal. Some days they do, some days they don't, some years they do, and some years they don't. But there are other stocks out there that have a different kind of role in a portfolio. Right? And about 20 years ago, when we had clients kind of in similar situations to where you find yourselves perhaps, we started investing in stocks that really paid dividends, rather than just focusing on appreciation. I'll give you a quick story. This is how this came to be. I was in a, I had a client for a long time, had a lot of money, and he died. And I went out and I met with the widow, and I met with the children, and the lawyer, and the accountant. Everybody in one room. And we sit down, everybody's making a chit-chat, and the first thing the wife says, the widow says, first thing she says, the money is in a trust. And I want to make sure that that trust is invested all in bonds. And I said, oh, that's interesting. You know, why is that? Are you really interested in safety? And it kind of came out, it took a little bit longer than the way I'm telling the story, it came out that the trust was written in a way that this woman was going to get the income during her lifetime, and only the income. She was never going to get the principal.
Good for her.
So she wanted the most income. By the way, the backstory is that those children in that room, those weren't her children. Those are the children from the first marriage. And this was the second wife. Right? So that's, when I figured that out, it made a lot more sense. So she wanted bonds. And you could see that her stepchildren were grinding their teeth a little bit, right? And so we made a suggestion that they actually took up, which was, we'll find stocks to you. They'll give you the same income that the bonds are going to pay, right? And here's what we're going to try and accomplish. One, you'll get the same income that the bonds would have paid. Two, that income's going to grow over time because bonds, remember, the bonds are fixed income. That coupon doesn't change. Where stocks, a lot of companies raise their dividends. Maybe not every year, but over time, they do raise their dividends. And three, even though you, the widow, are taking a little bit more risk here, your stepchildren, who are patiently waiting for their inheritance, or not so patiently as the case may be, are at least going to have a chance to keep up with inflation because those stocks, ideally, are going to grow over time. And that woman agreed, and those children, I think, were happy with that. And, you know, that was literally 20 years ago. Those people are still clients of ours, and they're still talking to each other, so we count that as a win. So let's talk about this. What we call it at our end, we call this equity income, right? It's just a made-up name, because equities is the word for stocks, fixed income is the word for bonds, equity income is meant to be someplace in the middle. So what kinds of things do we buy? My favorite example is Johnson & Johnson. Right? So Johnson & Johnson is the biggest healthcare company in the world. They issued a bond exactly a month ago. They issued a lot of bonds, but a month ago they issued a 5-year bond. You could lend money to Johnson & Johnson, they will pay you back 5 years, March 1st, 2021, that bond will mature. You will get your money back. The bonds were sold at par. Anybody want to guess what the coupon was on that bond?
2-3%.
1.65. 1.65% is the coupon. Now, except for the U.S. government, I would say that's probably the safest bond you could buy. I'm willing to bet that J&J will be around in 5 years, and you will get your money back. But you'll get exactly 1.65% every year for the next 5 years. That's one choice, buy J&J bonds. The other choice is you bought J&J stock. So, a couple of points. Johnson & Johnson stock at that time, a month ago, was yielding a little bit under 3%. So, I'm pretty good at math, and I can tell you real quick that 3 is more than 1.65. I can also tell you that a 3% dividend gets taxed at a lower rate than the interest income is. Interest on bonds is taxed as ordinary income. Could be taxed at your highest rate, whatever that happens to be. 39.6, I guess, is what we're using. Even more than that, if you include some other taxes they throw on. Dividend income, taxed at a lower rate, is at 15 or 20% qualified dividends. We're focusing on that. J&J would be a qualified dividend. So you get a higher rate, and you got a better tax treatment, and so happens, I went back and checked, J&J has increased their dividend every year, I'm not kidding, 54 years in a row. Now sometimes, not by very much, but 54 years in a row, they've been increasing their dividend. So, now, can J&J stock go down? I bet it could go down. It went down last year. Right? Now, despite what I'm telling you about J&J, the stock went down last year. Now, part of the problem for J&J and other companies is they do business all around the world. They sold lots of Band-Aids, they sold lots of drugs, all the things that they sell all around the world. Unit sales were fine. The dollar was so strong last year that if you translated those earnings back into U.S. dollars, it didn't look so good. And the stock was down. Not a lot, but it was down. And it could go down a lot. I mean, I don't mean to tout J&J. That's not the point here, right? The point is that we could find, you know, 30, 40, 50 stocks that will pay us 3% dividends, 4% dividends maybe, that will grow over time. I think there's a place for that in some people's portfolios. So that's my J&J example. The next example I would give you, kind of a very common example, is utility companies, electric and gas companies. Anybody here pay a bill to Florida Power and Light? Right? Anybody buy Florida Power and Light stock? So Florida Power and Light doesn't have a stock under that name. For a long time, it was called FPL. Not called that anymore either. A couple of years ago, they changed the name of the company for reasons that are not clear to me or I think to anybody else. The name of the company is now called Next Era, the next era. All right? And you may recognize that name. So this is an electric and gas company. You know, you pay your bills, and every year people run their air conditioners in Florida. You know what? Some years it's really hot. You guys run your air conditioners all day, every day. And some years, when it's not so hot, maybe you run it less. So their business can fluctuate, but this is a really, really boring business. Right? Highly regulated by the government. Monopoly. And boring. As an aside, this company happens to own more windmills than anybody else in the country. The windmills are not in Florida, by the way. The windmills are out in the Midwest. But this is a nice foreign company. And guess what? The dividend is 3%. They've actually raised their dividend every year for 20 years running, I think 22 actually, but don't quote me on that piece. And again, I'm not counting any one company, but companies like that, that are slow and steady, those are the tortoises. When you have the tortoise and the hare story, these are the tortoises. Right? This is not Netflix. This is not Amazon. You know, these are boring things that are going on. So we like the idea of owning utility stocks. All right? That third category I would give you. Real estate investment trusts. Right? Anybody get that question before? REITs is the acronym. These are stocks. They trade like stocks. Right? There are actually, I think, 26 of them in the S&P 500. They buy and sell just like stocks, but there's something special about them. A company that qualifies as a REIT doesn't pay corporate income tax. And to qualify, one of the things they've got to do is pay out 90% of their earnings to their investors. Perfect. That's just perfect for us, right? So basic business model is they own real estate, they collect the rent, pay whatever expenses there are, and they pay us the dividends. Distributions is actually the word, not dividends. Those dividends, just as an aside, are not qualified dividends. Remember earlier I said J&J's dividend lower tax rate, so REIT distributions are not qualified dividends, but they're still cash coming to you. And the average REIT, or many REITs at least, are paying 3%, 4%, maybe 5% dividends. You can find REITs that specialize in apartment buildings, or shopping centers, or office buildings, or timber, or anything else you can think of. You can find REITs that specialize in different parts of the country, although many of them are broadly based or around the entire country. So we like the idea of owning real estate. Over time, again, not every year, but over time, what tends to happen is rents go up. And over time, real estate tends to appreciate. And the REIT, first of all, distributions will grow. So if you're getting a 5% dividend now, hopefully that will grow over time. And REIT prices hopefully keep up with the value of real estate. Now, again, not every year. There are times when real estate goes down. There are times when REITs go down, for sure. And these are liquid markets, and you know, investors vote with their feet sometimes. But we like the idea of owning real estate investment trusts as part of a income-producing equity portfolio. The last one I'm going to throw out, although we don't do a lot of it right now, but just to keep in the back of your mind, is something called a convertible bond. Right? A lot of companies, at least 10 years ago, a lot of companies, when they issued bonds, wanted to reduce their cost. They wanted to pay a low interest rate. Now, one of the things they could do to entice you to buy their bond, even if the coupon was really low, was give you the right to convert your stock to shares of their company. Convert their bond to shares of their company. Sorry, I'll say it again. So you have the right to convert your bond to shares of their company. That's a conversion feature. From our point of view, as an investor's point of view, I got a couple of things going for me. The par value of that bond, those bonds have par values. Just like any other bond, a face amount, you get that back at maturity. That's your saving again. The coupon is your income stream. And that conversion feature, the right to take your $1,000 bond, you should be in increments of $1,000, take your $1,000 bond and convert it to 50 shares of stock. If the stock goes up, you have a chance to make some money. So we like that concept. We bought a lot of convertible bonds 10 years ago and 5 years ago. We haven't bought a lot recently for a couple of reasons. One, interest rates are so low that most companies who want to issue bonds don't need to do anything fancy to get a low coupon. They can just issue low bonds like Johnson & Johnson at 1.65%. So the companies that are issuing convertible bonds oftentimes are the companies that are really lousy balance sheets, really scary business models that are high risk. Those are the ones we're not looking to buy for our clients. So we haven't bought a lot of convertible bonds recently. The old bonds that have been out there, a couple of things have happened to them, right? If the stock has gone up, that means someone is going to, has the right to convert that bond, is probably going to buy that bond and short the stock and make a spread. That's a short description of convertible arbitrage. It's a fantastic business. It's not our business. But there are people, there are hedge funds out there who specialize in buying convertible bonds, selling the stock short, making a little spread. Good luck to them, but it's not what we do. The other end of the spectrum, you have convertible bonds, where the company has done terribly, and the stock has gone down, and the conversion feature is worthless. That's called a busted convert, or it's called a junk bond. Again, not really what we're looking to do for our clients. So the bonds in the middle, right, the bonds that have par values, that are meaningful, and decent coupons, and upside potential, if we can find them, we'll buy them. So, I just described four different types of securities that you kind of mix together. Real estate investor trusts, utility stocks, convertible bonds, and other dividend paying stocks. When I started this business, there were lots of kinds of companies that never paid a dividend. Dividends were a dirty word for the first 10 years that I was working in this industry. Right? People said, why are these companies paying dividends? They've got to earn money, pay corporate taxes, then they pay dividends, and the shareholders pay taxes on top of that. What's wrong with these companies? That's not very efficient. That's called double taxation of corporate income. Right? That was the expression. And no, you know, people thought companies that did that weren't very creative. But a couple of things changed 12 years ago now. First of all, they changed the tax law. Right? That was President Bush II who arranged to have lower taxes on qualified dividends. All of a sudden, the taxes weren't so onerous. And then we had all those scandals back in 2000, 2001, 2002. Enron and WorldCom and Tyco and a bunch of others, and people who have been fooled or misled by watching earnings, you know, corporate earnings reports that turned out not to be true, all of a sudden realize that when your earnings could be untrue, right? It could be misleading. Dividends have to be real. If a company declares a dividend, you know whether or not you get a check in the mail, right? You can't fake a dividend. And so all of a sudden, dividends became much more interesting to people. And so I would say the last 12 years or so, dividends have gotten much more in favor. Right? We find that dividend-paying stocks tend to give you less volatility than stocks that don't pay dividends. Right? If you think of what worked last year, 2015, don't know if you've heard this expression, the stocks that went up last year for them at least are called FANG, F-A-N-G. Anybody know what that stands for?
Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google.
Exactly right. Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google. The only thing that's changed a little bit is there's no stock called Google anymore. Name of the company is?
Alphabet.
The stock symbol is still G-O-O-G, by the way, or G-O-O-G-L, but those four companies, on average, last year, those four were up 80%, 80%. Now, the S&P itself was only up 1.3%, I think, for the year, 1.7 or something like that. If you take those four out, the rest of the market was actually down last year. So, one thing about those stocks, none of them, not one of those four, paid a dividend. Right? So, those are the kinds of things that when growth stocks are working, they can be spectacular. When value-oriented stocks or dividend-paying stocks work, they can be terrific too. Now, so far this year, I think the best-performing sector in 2016 happens to be utilities. Plain old boring utilities have done very well this year after being laggards last year. So, no matter what kind of stocks you buy, there are going to be cycles when they're good and cycles when they're not. But if your goal is to live on your income and hopefully keep up with inflation, I think stocks that are paying dividends, where you think the dividends are going to grow over time, actually play a part in your portfolio. The most important decision that I think people can make for their portfolios, and this is not just for retirees, this is for anybody, it's not should you buy, Google or Facebook, pick one. That's not the question. And the question is not, do you buy growth stocks or value stocks? The question really is, do you buy stocks or bonds? Or really, what mix of stocks and bonds? That asset allocation question is the single most important determination of how much risk you're taking and what kind of returns you should expect over the long term. Right? So, to answer that question, there is not a right answer for everybody. It's going to be different for each person. And there's kind of two ways, I think, to try and answer the question for yourselves. One is to kind of judge your personality. How much risk are you willing to take? And how terrible are you going to feel if the market is down 10% or 20% or 30%? Right? Because having bonds in the portfolio, traditionally bonds are not going to go down if the stock market goes down. In fact, typically bonds do well when the stock market goes down. Or conversely. And so the more bonds you have, the less volatility your overall portfolio is going to have. If you need to dampen that volatility to keep your sanity, then you should do that. Right? The first rule we have is the clients have to sleep at night. Right? If I'm putting all your money in the stock market because I think it's the best thing to do, and you're not sleeping at night, that's not the right program. So you got to decide for yourself how much you need in bonds to keep you safe, and how much you need in stocks to try and keep up with inflation and grow your portfolio over time. Right, so there's the how much risk can you stomach test. The other way is a little bit more scientific. And it involves trying to go back and really take stock of your situation. Understand all of your liquid assets, right? All of your stocks, all of your bonds, all of your bank accounts, anything that you can invest, IRAs, personal accounts, trust accounts, all of it. Get it all on one page, figure out how much do you have. And then the hard part is to figure out what you need. What do you need to live the way you want to live? Right? That ratio is really critical. Right? Because if your goal, and I'm not projecting here, but a lot of clients that I talk to tell me their goal is not to outlive their money. Right? No one wants to go to their children and ask for help. You may be able to do that if you have to, but no one wants to do that, at least no one that I've talked to. So if you want to make sure your money lasts as long as you do, need to understand the dynamics that are going on. So imagine you've got $10 million, just to make an exciting example, and you need, $100,000 a year to live on. Right? My math is correct in my head. That's 1%. If that's what you need to achieve your goals, I'm not sure you should buy stocks. You could buy bonds. You could buy high-quality short-term bonds, pay the taxes on them, and you'll have enough to live on, and your principal will be absolutely safe. Now, if you're lucky enough to be in that position, great. No, seriously, that's terrific. But I'm going to change the facts a little bit. Instead of having $10 million, I'm going to give you $3 million. That's still a lot of money. But instead of needing 100, you're going to need, in my example, 120. Right? And I'm picking numbers, but I can do the math in my head. If I did it right, I think that's 4% return. Right? So you have $3 million earning 4%, that's $120,000. Right? But you got to think all the way through. First of all, it's got to be taxes. Right? To earn money, you've got to pay taxes to the government. That's how it works. So you don't really need four, you need six. And because you're going to pay some money to the government. You can spend four, but the government gets their share. And on top of that, ideally, you like to earn a little bit more because you want to keep up with inflation. So depending on how old you are and your time horizons, maybe you would like to earn more than six. Maybe you'd like to earn seven or eight. Right? And that was really the example. Buying bonds is not going to get you there. Right? Buying bonds, buying J&J bonds, that's paying 1.65%, going to come up short. Now, there's nothing against the law that says the drawing down principle is wrong, right? You can spend your principal if you want, but if you do that, if you can picture a chart how this looks, how much money you have, once you start drawing down principal, it starts coming down more sharply, because now you've got less principal earning less income. You can suck down more principal each year, and it starts to really dissipate. So there comes a cliff, you start drawing down principal, and you go past it, you've kind of got a bad cycle going. So in that scenario, in order to get, ideally, let's say we're trying to get 7% for a number. 7% means you give some money to the government, you can reinvest some for inflation, and you can still spend 4%. Well, how are you going to get 7? You can have some bonds, but you better have some stocks too. Right? Now remember what I said earlier. The average return for the stock market over the last 70 years is running between 10 and 12%. And the average return for the bond market is running, again, over 70 years, kind of 4 to 6. So some combination of those things might work. But it's hard to get good returns from the bond market now, and it's hard to stomach the volatility of the stock market, right? So it's not an easy thing to do. Retirement investing now is not easy because the world is a very difficult place. Well, I could buy bonds. Remember, when I started in 1989, I was buying treasuries paying 8%. Sign me up. Where do we do that? Right? Sign me up for that again. We may get there someday, right? So the answer you come up with now for asset allocation is not going to be carved in stone. Given what interest rates are available in bonds, very low, you may decide to have less in bonds now and more in stocks. And then a year from now, or 2 years from now, or 3 years from now, when interest rates are higher, you may change your asset allocation. So the last thing I would kind of leave you with, just a little bit of an advertisement. Middle ground that I described that I call equity income. What we're trying to accomplish for clients is to generate an average annual return of 7 to 9%. Half of that is coming from income. Really steady, every quarter, one can project that very easily. The other half is coming from appreciation, which is incredibly lumpy. Right? But if you can generate 3, 4, 5% income along the way, and hopefully 3, 4, 5% of appreciation on average over a full cycle along the way and get returns to 7 to 9%, that might get you where you need to go. So a lot of our clients, they have bonds, they have traditional stocks, they've got some money set aside in equity income as a way to try and dampen the volatility, not hit home runs, but at least not be on a roller coaster either. Okay, I didn't mean for this to be a monologue. Someone's waving at me.
Address is your firm's charges to manage portfolios.
So, our firm charges a management fee based on the value of the account. And that fee varies between stocks and bonds. And it also varies based on the size of the account. So it's not an easy answer. Is there a formula in the back there, in the book?
No, it's not.
You could. We're going to take questions. Mark's going to help me answer them. Right. Yes.
I'll take over. Thank you. For fixed income, individual separate account management, where you own the actual underlying bonds, the fee is 0.375%. There are no spreads. There are no commissions. There are no custody fees. For equities, for the separate account, the MLG equity income strategy that Rich referenced, in the separate account format, the fee starts at 1.5% and
then goes down every $2.5 million. So assuming at the $10 million level, you're at 90 basis points. That's the next real big break.
By the way, if you have a balanced account, stocks and bonds, you get a blended rate. So it might wind up to be less, 1% or less for smaller numbers. And just to make one more point that Marc said, I want to make sure everybody hears it. There's no commissions on any trades, right? So we can buy and sell every day, although we don't. But we could, it wouldn't cost you anything. There's no custody charges, no reporting charges. There's no markup on bonds. Sometimes when you buy a bond from a brokerage firm, you're buying it from them, right? So they buy it for X, and they pick a price, and they sell it to you for a higher price. You don't see that markup, but it's there. For us, because we're charging a fee, there's no markup on the bonds.
Other things, there's a lot of different ways to cut this. You know, there's things like family billing, where all different family relationships are effectively added together to get down the various break points on fees. Outside of that, the more traditional mutual fund structure, Rich and his group do, in fact, run a mutual fund in this format. And the fee is approximately 70 basis points.
Yes, 0.7%.
There's positives and negatives with mutual funds. You know, there's certain customization you can do with separate accounts, tax loss harvesting, all these different things. So, but there's everything in between. And if coming directly to Neuberger, you're giving the institutional share class on the mutual fund at 70 basis points versus doing the example through a broker or something like that. You have sales charges and all these different things.
Right. By mutual funds, you would prefer not to pay a commission or a load, is the expression you should ask for the institutional share class if you can get it. Yes, ma'am.
Do you have anything to say about annuities?
Annuities are interesting. I don't think now is a great time to buy an annuity because the insurance company is looking at interest rates in terms of how they quote things to people. And so the fact that interest rates are low results in a lower payout. There are so many variations of annuities, it's hard to be specific, but the traditional annuity, you give the insurance company a lump sum of money, or stocks, whatever, and they promise to pay you a specific amount of money every year as long as you're alive. So the first question you need to think about is, how's your health? Because if you give them $1 million, they're going to pay you $80,000 a year for the next, as long as you're alive, and you die after a year, that was a really bad bet, right? So now you can buy a joint survivor annuity, where a husband and wife get it for almost either one of them is alive, and there are a dozen other variations with a 10-year certain and pop-ups, and so those are... they could be interesting, and you know, if you hope and expect to live a long time, annuities could make sense. But typically, when interest rates are higher, they're a better investment option. Now, those are fixed annuities, right? Variable annuities is really something different entirely. Variable annuity is they take your money, they put it in a mutual fund, it can go up or down, they wrap it, the insurance wrapper or annuity wrapper makes it tax free, so there's some tax benefits there, but not nearly the safety that you would expect from a fixed annuity. So to me, that's a different animal entirely. That's a mutual fund. It's dressed up to be something different for tax purposes. But with fixed annuities, I would say most of our clients don't do it. I would tell you one exception. I don't know. Charitable gift annuities, anybody familiar with that concept? I had a client last year, last December, who wanted a charitable deduction. He had a very big unexpected capital gain. He wanted a charitable deduction in December. So he took $1 million. This is real life case. The woman was 78 years old. Took $1 million, and she went to UJA in New York, right? United Jewish Appeal of States, right? UJA Federation. Gave them $1 million check on December 20-something, and they promised to pay her $80,000 a year as long as she's alive. So a couple of benefits to that. One, that felt like a good interest rate to her. Now, some of your own money coming back to you, right? But it felt like a good return. Two, she had a $400,000 charitable deduction, right? That is what the IRS says is the present value of what the charity's going to get eventually based on their life expectancy tables. And so that served a lot of purposes, a charitable gift and a tax deduction. And there was charitably inclined, obviously. And so to me, that made more sense. Now, there are a lot of ways to skin that cat. You can do charitable remainder trust and, you know, all kinds of things that could have been done if it hadn't been the last 2 weeks of the year. but that was a simple solution in that case.
The other thing worth noting, the fees in annuities, whether it be variable or fixed, oftentimes are tremendous and hidden in a lot of different ways.
You said it a little
longer. The fees on these annuities are just, in many cases, in my opinion, at least a bit obscene.
The insurance companies aren't getting their pound of flesh. You don't see it, but they, you know, people are paid to sell life insurance and annuities handsomely. So that comes out of the value that the customers get. Yes, sir, we'll come to you, I promise.
What's your feeling about mortgage rates? Mortgage REITs.
Mortgage REITs.
Like Adelaide or Bank 14%.
So mortgage REITs, they don't own real estate. They lend money to real estate companies. They're taking a risk there, and some of them are interesting. Two that we like in particular, one is from Blackstone. The other one is from Starwood. So there are two companies that lend money to real estate or otherwise. They pay 8 or 9% in those cases. There's some risk there. They kind of act like junk bonds almost. So you're lending money to a company, and they are lending money out, and you're kind of getting the interest through. So it's kind of like an organized junk bond in a sense. Generally speaking, for safety purposes, I'd rather own equity units that actually own real estate and take my chances on real estate going up and making loans in the industry. Very important in all companies, but management quality is very important in mortgage REITs, because there's a lot of room to take a lot of risk if you want to. You don't get a 40% return yield unless there's some risk buried in there someplace.
Well, they're leveraged also, weren't they?
They're leveraged, exactly right. Over here, you.
What's the market for preferred shares?
Preferred stock is the question, right? So typical preferred stock is higher up the ladder than common stock in terms of safety, lower down than bonds. A lot of them have, you know, pretty attractive dividends. They're going to act like bonds. They're going to act like long-term bonds. Most of them don't have maturity dates. They're perpetual preferreds. And some that do have maturity dates could be, you know, 30, 50 years out in the future. So the coupons look interesting right now, but when rates go up, if that does in fact happen, I'm afraid those are going to lose value. So they should have been $25, typically $25 or $50 par values. And so they're not going to trade up, right? The reason they're not going to trade up is they typically call after so many years. So they're never going to go up to 30 because they can call them at 25. But they could trade down, and they could trade down if interest rates go up. They could also trade down if the issuer gets to be, you know, a risky credit. So we tend not to own regular preferred stocks. Sometimes we'll buy convertible preferreds because at least there you've got that kicker that if the stock happens to do well, the common stock, you've got a chance to make some extra money. But generally speaking, we kept away from the preferreds. There are new ones out, I'll tell you. There are new ones out that are called fixed to float preferreds. Wells Fargo and a couple of other companies have issued them. So if you follow the words, fixed means that you have a fixed preferred for 5 years typically, and after that, the rate, dividend rate, floats with LIBOR or some other metric they're going to use. So at least if rates are going up, you're kind of protected. You're going to get a higher return down the road. So if I had to buy a preferred, I would look for those. We'll come to you next.
What do you think about hedge funds?
Hedge funds. Mark and I might see this differently, but I'm going to answer first. I'm older. So hedge funds are not really an investment strategy. Hedge funds are a compensation scheme. They're a compensation scheme.
Oh, okay.
So originally, and I know it sounds funny, but I'm really deadly serious. Originally, hedge funds were meant that they would hedge their bets, and they would protect you in up or down markets. They'd be long stocks, and they would sell us other stocks short, and they would try and, so where the market was going, it didn't matter. The concept is great. Typical hedge fund, for a long time, would charge 1% management fee, and they would take 20% of the profits. So now, that wasn't enough, because that was, you know, they weren't making enough money at that rate. So now they get 2 of 20, is the expression. And hedge funds could specialize in any strategy you can imagine. There's a hedge fund for that. So when I said convertible arbitrage before, a lot of funds do that. Risk arbitrage and, you know, long, traditional long short and macro funds. And anything you can think of, there's a hedge fund. And the only thing that keeps them in the same category is 2 and 20. And to me, personally, I'll be damned if I'm paying somebody 2%, 20% of the profits to manage my money. I'm just not going to do it. Having said that, right, having said that, Neuberger Berman does offer hedge funds. So there are other people who work for my company who are in this business, and Marc can tell you how great they are, right?
No. I don't disagree with this sentiment. The fees are very high. And there's different ways they've gotten the returns they have in the past, whether it be leverage or doing a lot of the same things you can achieve by just choosing the right mix of assets, whether it be more bonds or more equities or whatever the case may be. What you are seeing right now in the industry is that there's been a lot of pressure on the fees themselves, and there's the desire, given the fact there's all these big pension funds out there, whole pension fund system, defined benefit plan, the market is shrinking. These companies aren't doing that anymore in favor of 401ks and things like that. As a result, the hedge funds have gotten smarter. And they know that their typical client, the pension funds out there, aren't going to exist in years. So instead, they're trying to get into the mutual fund world. And they realize the mutual fund world is not willing to pay 2 and 20. So Neuberger has contracted with various funds to, in fact, manage the same type of hedge strategies, but for much lower fee rates, typically below 1% as opposed to 2 and 20. And that's where you're seeing the industry go now, doing what's called these liquid alternatives. And again, it's just one more tool in the toolbox of
I should add that my that opinion was my opinion, not the purpose of it. Just to clarify.
It's going to be.
I realize that. Such is life. That was my opinion. Question over here.
Do you use ETFs in your portfolios?
ETFs. Tell everybody what ETFs stand for.
Exchange traded funds.
So exchange traded funds. That's a version of a mutual fund, and. We'll use them rarely. I think there's something that I want to invest in that is very risky and perhaps illiquid. An ETF might make sense. I'll give you an example. If I wanted to invest in the biotech sector, which, you know, there's 15, maybe 20 companies, you know, that are big players in biotech, and one of them, you know, hopefully is going to cure cancer, right, or something like that. And if you own the stock, you're going to make a lot of money. But I don't know which one. And I don't think anybody knows which one. And so rather than pick a biotech company for you, pick one of them and say, okay, I think this is the one. I might buy an ETF that owns 18 different biotech stocks and give you exposure that way. I might do it with, you know, 2% of your portfolio. We happen not to be doing that at the moment, but that's something I might do. Green energy is another example. You know, there are a lot of companies out there who are trying to create the new, you know, invention that will create cheap solar energy or wind or geothermal or et cetera, batteries. So I don't know which one's going to succeed. I hope one of them succeeds, but I might buy an ETF for green energy rather than buying one company in that area. So, but generally speaking, we don't use a lot of ETFs.
From our perspective as asset allocators for our clients, we occasionally will use them, but generally, you have to remember, we're coming from the bias, we're an active management shop. That is our knitting. The client's expectation when they do come to us is to outperform net of fees over a full market cycle.
Yes, ma'am.
You didn't mention commodities.
Commodities? So, we don't invest in commodities directly. But I would tell you that commodity prices are incredibly important to what's going on in the stock market right now. So I think actually this quarter, more than, I don't know if it's literally true, but I think it is, more than ever before, the price of oil and the price of the S&P 500 is more correlated now this last 3 months than I can ever remember. It's just incredible what's going on. And it actually doesn't make any sense to me, for I'll tell you why in a second. But so if you want to express an opinion on oil in particular, there are lots of companies you can buy, Exxon being the easy example, but lots of companies you can buy that will express that opinion. So here's what's happened, I think. When oil prices go down, people are saying to themselves, oh, oil prices are down. It must mean demand for energy is down. That must mean we're going into recession. The stock market should go down. Now, oil has gone from over $100 a barrel to 27 6 weeks ago. So that's one hell of a drop. People are saying, wow, that means we're going into recession. I don't think that's true. Demand for oil, demand for energy, is not down. It's not. You see, there are statistics to show. The problem with oil prices is that supply is way up. Saudi Arabia is pumping oil at the highest level they have ever done. So is Russia. Iran has now come back online. And if you look at a chart of U.S. oil production over the last 10 years, you'd be astounded at how much we've improved oil and gas production in the U.S. All this fracking and horizontal drilling and all these things you're hearing about, U.S. oil production is up dramatically. So for all those reasons, we have bigger inventory of oil, more oil being produced, no place to store it, oil prices went down dramatically. It is not a demand problem, I don't think. It's a supply problem. A supply problem gets cured one way. You drill for less oil. And if you look at how many rigs are being used to drill for oil and gas in the United States, it is down dramatically in the last 12 months. Now, if you're an oil company, you put up a rig in the Gulf of Mexico, you invest a lot of money, and you don't see anything for 3 years. That's how long it takes. You sunk that money 3 years ago, you're going to finish that well, and you're going to pump that oil. You've sunk the cost of it. But the number of new rigs going into production is way down. So gradually, U.S. oil production is going to come down. It's already started. If you look at a chart, it's turned that peak and started to come down a little bit. Still way higher than it was 10 years ago, or even 5 years ago. So when you see oil production come down, you see natural gas production, there are so few rigs drilling for natural gas now that it's crazy. The natural gas under two is terrible for these companies. But we think the natural price for oil should be in the 40s or 50s, and for gas should be, $4, not 180 or 2. So we express that by buying stocks that will benefit from higher oil and gas prices.
Last question.
Well, yes, sir.
Talking about oil and all that. MLPs?
MLPs. Tell them what it stands for.
Master Limited Partnerships.
So that is an acronym for a type of company, like a REIT. They don't pay corporate taxes. That's what defines an MLP. It's taxed as a partnership, not a corporation. No corporate taxes. Now, most people, and I gather you too, when they say MLPs, are thinking about a particular kind of MLP. They're talking about pipeline companies. There are a lot of pipeline companies that are organized along those lines in this country. And so this is energy infrastructure. They don't drill for oil. They don't sell oil. They just move it. Right? These are pipelines all around the country. And typically, there's a general partner, and there are limited partners. The method is that the limited partnership issues new units to people, to the public, and they buy properties from the general partner, and drop it down as the expression, and when it works, it's a thing of beauty. You get very high distributions, 4, 5, 6%, maybe sometimes 8, 9, 10%, and you get dividend growth, distribution growth is actually the right word. So first of all, is it not qualified dividends? You get K-1s, which makes a mess of your tax return, but more to the point, the risk here it's pretty high. These companies are sometimes very highly levered. And when they cut a dividend, right, all of a sudden oil and gas production is going to go down, and there's less oil flowing through the pipes, or gas flowing through the pipes. And if you cut a dividend, stocks are going to get hammered. So the biggest MLP in the country, actually it wasn't MLP, but the biggest pipeline company, Kinder Morgan, anybody know Kinder Morgan? KMI? Cut their dividend by 75% a couple months back. Stock got knocked down pretty hard. There may be other MLPs out there who find themselves with stranded pipelines. In other words, there's less drilling going on, less production, they're going to have a problem. Now, a lot of the contracts they have are take-or-pay contracts. Whoever signed to ship their gas, or oil, is obligated to pay them whether they use the pipeline or not. That sounds great until the oil company goes bankrupt. Then you've got a problem. So there are a lot of oil wells drilled at $180, at $60 a barrel that look great at the time, and at $27, if that's where prices are going to be, are not going to make it. Now Exxon's going to make it. Exxon's going to be fine. Exxon's going to go from AAA to AA not going to miss a dividend, not going to, you know, not going to pass on their contracts. But there are a lot of oil companies that if oil goes to 20, which is what some people are saying, are not going to make it. So it's a very difficult area right now. You got Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley both on record as saying oil's going to 20. Goldman Sachs just hasn't changed their mind. You got lots of people. No, they did. No.
It's a lot of changed their mind.
I'm sorry?
A year ago, they said it's going to go to 250, remember?
Well, that was more than a year and a half. But yes, they had 200 now, then they had 20, and now they're changing it. But there are a lot of people at 20, and I got people, a lot of people, who think oil's going back to 50 on its way to 80. And the really funny thing is that they both could be right. In the short run, if production is high and storage is low, or storage is still in, so you can't pick anymore, oil prices are going to come down on the spot market. They will. They could get to 20. But over the next year or two, if production slows dramatically and demand keeps growing at a relatively steady pace, you can see oil at 50, you can see oil at 80. I mean, you don't know. So about 7% of the S&P is invested in energy stocks, Exxon, Chevron, those kinds of names, down from a much higher number 2 years ago. But about 7% is in energy, and I would tell you that in our portfolios, we're roughly that weight. You know, 6 and 8, 5 to 9, in that range. We don't want to make a big bet on energy right now. I don't know where it's going in the short run.
Third world countries as they become more productive, so
yes, demand is growing in third world emerging markets. I think that was the last question. So thank you all very much.
I want to thank Rich, Marc. I think the art form that Rich showed us is that he made a very complicated, complex set of concepts sound really simple and straightforward. And that is terrific. Thank you so much for that. I guess you guys can stay around if you have any specific questions you want to ask.
It'd be our pleasure. And,
brochures are in the back. I hope you pick up one of our brochures. And contact me if you have some interest in helping
support. And I have tickets.
Tickets over here.
Yeah, tickets over there. And then the other thing is, clearly we have more than an excess of cookies. So if you brought a bag with you, this is the idea. Look, we'll see you all the 21st with Sheriff Scott Israel. And thank you very much. And thank you very much, guys.
Thanks, sir.